The village that was to become our town of Norwood was still a small farming community well into the 19th century. Though first settled in the 17th century, it remained a village within the town of Dedham until after the Civil War. Two events guided the village of South Dedham towards its independence. The first, which accelerated the growth of the village and changed the complexion of the town for a century to follow, was the arrival of the railroad in the 1840s. Running through the heart of South Dedham, it then split to the southwest and southeast. The railroad would bring industry and jobs to South Dedham. It would soon change it from an agricultural village to a manufacturing town. The second event, which would gradually change the village, was the formation of its first volunteer fire companies. As most other settlements in New England, South Dedham had long depended on its residents to come together to fight a fire whenever the need arose. It was standard in the earliest days of the village that every able-bodied man do his part in fighting fires, just as he would be required to serve in the militia. In fact, each man was to own two buckets so that he could take his part in the bucket brigade. The mother town of Dedham provided no other service of fire protection to the village, and there was no demand for it until 1833, when a great forest fire burned a great deal of South Dedham. The blaze, which required the help of a great many communities, destroyed almost the entire northwest quarter of the town. Having seen firsthand the destructive force of an unchecked fire of this magnitude, the people of South Dedham demanded fire protection from its town fathers. They demanded that a firehouse be built and equipped, and that a fire company be raised from the village. So, on April 22nd, the first fire company was formed in South Dedham. Named Washington No. 7, the first firehouse was placed just at the edge of the great blaze which brought about its formation. It occupied the location where St. Catherine's Cardinal Cushing Hall now stands. At the time, the street was called Center Street. It wouldn't become Washington Street until it was so renamed by the young town of Norwood in the centennial year of 1876. The selectmen of Dedham carefully appointed 40 members to the new fire company. The village of South Dedham must have thought this was a good start, but not good enough, as they pushed for the formation of a second company. A year to the date from the formation of Washington No. 7, the town fathers selected 40 additional volunteers and formed the American No. 10 Fire Company. They were housed in a station erected further south on current-day Washington Street, opposite the bottom of Walnut Avenue. Quite naturally, the fire companies offered the village more than fire protection. As time passed, the fire companies became as much, if not more so, social and political organizations to some extent. In larger towns and cities, the volunteer fire companies became major political forces. William Tweed, who would one day rise to become the head of New York's Tammany Hall, and whose moniker Boss Tweed would be synonymous with corrupt politics, got his first taste of power in Manhattan's Big Six Fire Company. While South Dedham's fire companies would never rival big city fire companies as political players, membership in the companies would bring a certain amount of prestige, and the support of the membership would be influential in events affecting the town. The late Wynne Everett, an early Norwood historian, wrote in the 1930s about the volunteer fire companies which were formed 100 years before. Scanning the membership lists of the two companies, he recognized the names of many who would later become leaders in commerce and town politics. The same men would one day go off to fight the Civil War, and when they returned, work towards the secession of South Dedham from its mother town. Everett suggested that it was at the firehouse where many of the town's fathers developed their leadership abilities. From the outset, the two companies were intensely competitive. Fortunately for South Dedham, Washington No. 7 and American No. 10 saved their competitive juices for the exhibitions they put on for the townspeople. It wasn't always the case elsewhere, especially in larger towns and cities where rival companies often became violent towards one another. For instance, Martin Scorsese's recent film, Gangs of New York, accurately portrayed rival fire companies battling each other in the street while buildings burned. Early apparatus consisted of wagons bearing hand tubs, ladders, and hose. Pulled to the scene of the fire by men or horses, lengths of the hose would be put into the nearest water supply. There were reservoirs located throughout the village for this purpose. The hand tubs were nothing more than manual pumps designed to deliver the water to the fire. Later, steam engines would perform this task. Motorized apparatus would arrive around the turn of the century, but horses were still used well into the 20th century. South Dedham's fire companies constantly were challenged to improve their ability to fight fire. After the railroad arrived, factories of every kind began to appear on either side of the tracks, almost the entire length of the town. A tannery occupied large tracts of land from Manhattan Street to Railroad Avenue, taking up much of the land now occupied by the Norwood Hospital was the Everett Furniture Factory. The land along the tracks between the two was a site of car shops built for the maintenance of the rail cars themselves. The Norwood Press and later the Plimpton Press would be built. Another tannery was built at Endicott Street. The Morrow Ink Works, which was to become the largest ink mill in the world, developed along the tracks which headed off to the southeast. As a result, the village of South Dedham, soon to be the town of Norwood, had a particularly strong interest in providing fire protection. The industries attracted to the land along the railroad, in turn, attracted people in search of jobs. A fire at any one of these sites could be devastating to the fortunes of the community, placing significant parts of the population out of work. The townspeople experienced this firsthand when the Everett Furniture Factory, the largest employer in town, burned in May 1865. It was never to be rebuilt. By the end of the Civil War, South Dedham's identity as a manufacturing hub had been firmly established. There was also growing displeasure with the village's treatment by the central government in Dedham. Among the grievances of the village, which steered the townspeople towards separation from Dedham, was the refusal of Dedham to build a high school for South Dedham. The people's bitterness towards Dedham was most evident among the membership of the Washington No. 7 Fire Company. Having long been the organization which could offer alternatives to the entertainment-starved people with its musters, exhibitions, and annual firemen's ball, the fire companies were now a device of social change. Their actions would be noticed. Thus, the mother town of Dedham was mortified when in October 1868, the South Dedham Fire Companies voted not to participate in the parade and festivities planned for the dedication of the Civil War Memorial Building erected at High and Washington Streets in Dedham. The village was on a course for its independence from Dedham. Perhaps the final push again involved the firemen. The Dedham Board of Selectmen decreed that the Washington No. 7 Fire Company would not be allowed to ring its bell at dawn on the 4th of July in 1871. The fire company had traditionally rung in the day of celebration for decades. Determined members of the fire company defied the edict and rang the bell long and loud, sending the message. Before the following spring, the town of Norwood would be incorporated by an act of the state legislature. One of the first acts of the new town was to rename Washington No. 7 and America No. 10 as Norwood No. 1 and Norwood No. 2, respectively. From its inception as a town in 1872 through the middle of the 1890s, Norwood's law enforcement function was ably conducted by constables, special police officers, and the Norfolk County Sheriff. There was no regular patrol to deter crime or public nuisances. Special officers would respond upon being summoned from their homes or from their businesses in the event of emergencies. Fortunately, there were few. The railroad, which attracted employers, also had another effect on the town. It also brought people with little or no interest in working to the towns and villages that dotted the landscape along the railroads. The transient population, which characteristically traveled by rail, albeit on top or underneath the cars, or if they were lucky, inside an empty boxcar, began to become a problem for the town. Called tramps, vagrants, or hobos, these kings of the road created a nuisance. They depended on the charity of townspeople who had little to give. Wherever they roamed, they were prepared to commit petty larcenies or scams to improve their lot. During cold weather, it fell upon the town to provide overnight accommodations for this displaced population. This was to keep tramps from trying to find shelter in people's homes, barns, cellars, and sheds. Deemed a necessity for some time, the town of Norwood, in what was probably its first municipal building project, built a little brick lock up on Market Street, which is now Central Street, in 1879. The appropriation of $1,250 was exceeded when the expenditure for its construction totaled $1,367.15. The lockup was used for prisoners awaiting transportation to court. However, the predominant use of the lockup was to give a night's lodging to tramps. In fact, it wasn't until 1903 that two steel cells and a concrete walled cell were added. Despite moving the police department several times The building was in use continuously to house prisoners for 85 years. The next municipal building project was the construction of a new firehouse, complete with a bell tower, in 1887. This building was erected next to the lockup on Market Street in what is now the Town Hall parking lot. The former Norwood No. 1 was closed, and the bell from that house was placed in the new firehouse. Norwood No. 2 remained in use for some time to come. The companies had been merged to become the Norwood Fire Department the previous year. Though the department would remain as an all-call fire department well into the 20th century, rules and regulations for the Norwood Fire Department were established in 1886. Norwood continued to grow, and while incidents of crime were low, nuisances appeared to be ever-present. An increasingly loud call for a regular police force was heralded on the pages of the Norwood Advertiser, which appears to have been an influential voice in the community, particularly in the temperance movement, which warned of the evils of alcohol. Reporting the arrest by special officers Rhodes and Cleary of four men drinking liquor in the woods at Howard Street, the editor of the Norwood Advertiser wrote, "A large empty jar was found, which smelled very strong of spirits, and a bottle of the horrid stuff was found nearby." He offered that the men must have obtained the liquor at one of two places known to sell illegally, and preached that it is too bad that the drink orgies of the men who will imbibe in intoxicants annoy and alarm law-abiding and decent townspeople. In another report of an arrest, he reports of special officers Rhodes and Creed arresting a farmhand from Walpole who, while drunk, backed his horse-drawn wagon into a store window. The Advertiser reported that the man imbibed too freely of that which put into one's mouth steals away the brain. He hoped that the man would endeavor hereafter to leave intoxicants alone, for as sure as fate, the mischief wrought by alcohol will tell against every man who meddles with it. Such constant reports and editorials in the Advertiser certainly led to the call for the establishment of a full-time police force, one designed to perform preventive patrol rather than to react to nuisances and crimes already committed. On May 1st, 1896, the town appointed its first full-time police department. Warren Rhodes, a constable and special officer for 13 years, was appointed the chief of police. Michael D. Creed, a constable and special officer for 6 years, was appointed the first patrolman and was assigned to night patrol. The first police department was housed in the rear of a building at 540 Washington Street, the current location of the left stairway from Washington Street down to the municipal parking lot north of the town hall. The town was now better suited to provide a deterrent to crime and nuisances, and within a few years was able to deal with the problems wrought by tramps and hobos, which had been draining the town's resources for some time. For instance, in 1899, 56 arrests were made for various offenses. However, there were 2,303 tramps booked for a night's lodging in the lockup. As this lodging of the tourist fraternity is only done during the cold weather, 7 months at the most, they averaged 10 or 12 per night at the little brick lockup. The vagrants were given something to eat as well at their departure in the morning. Nothing too fancy, of course, some crackers and water, but even that became a drain on the public budget. So one fine morning, when there was a sizable delegation in the local jail, the jailer refused to open the door. Repeating a strategy employed in New York City a short time earlier, when Theodore Roosevelt was police commissioner, the vagrants were brought to the court, and many of them began labors of varying duration for the county. It was surprising to note how quickly Norwood was blacklisted by the hobo fraternity. For a long time, Norwood was shunned by the professional drifter. Hobo markings warning others of active or unfriendly police would appear on the signposts entering the town. In 1900, the town offices, including the police, temporarily moved into the second floor of the firehouse. Though the police would eventually move out, the town occupied these temporary quarters for 28 years. For several years, all of the town offices, including the police and fire department, shared the cramped Market Street building. Apparently, the town was not yet ready to build a permanent town hall. So in order to alleviate the crowding, a modern brick firehouse was built across the street. The fire department occupied the building in October of 1907. From the annual report of the Board of Fire Engineers, the town is now provided with a new and up-to-date central fire station, which is equipped with many of the latest appliances for fighting fires, including a fine hook and ladder truck, three good serviceable horses, and many of the accessories of an up-to-date firehouse. On the upper floors are sleeping rooms, an engineer's room, two assembly rooms, a fire alarm room, a bathroom, laboratory, etc. The lowest floor is occupied by the apparatus and horses, with a stable in the rear, automatic arrangements for quick hitching and quick egress from the rear of the building. The apparatus doors of the old firehouse were removed, and the town offices took over the entire building. The bell from the old Washington No. 7 remained in the tower. The police department, also growing, remained in the temporary town hall. As the fire department moved into its new home, Police Chief Fred Sackett assumed the duties of his office, having been appointed upon the retirement of Chief Warren Rhodes. Shortly thereafter, in February of 1908, he made the department's annual report. In it, he reported on the condition of the police station as he found it.
I desire to call your attention to the deplorable condition of the police station. There is but one room, and that is a back room, and parties in the front can easily hear all conversations. We are bothered by cockroaches, which we are fighting to get rid of. With your approval, I purchased a desk, chairs, books, and things necessary for this department. I now have a one-party telephone line.
By 1912, Chief Sackett was gone, but the police station problem had still not been solved. As a harbinger of things to come, several times over the next 86 years, a 1912 newspaper reports the formation of a committee to search for a space to house or a location to build a new police station. The result was to put the police department, temporarily, on the second floor of the firehouse. The police department was given space on the second floor front of the firehouse on Market Street. The department continued to use the lockup conveniently located across the street. The police department finally had respectable quarters in which to conduct the business with the public. One would have to look closely to notice the police station lettering on the second floor window, or perhaps even the globe over the building's entrance. However, according to the late Charlie Coughlin, the undeniable expert of all things about Norwood, there was no mistaking the police presence when the barrel-chested Sergeant Wally Riedel would bellow commands from the second floor window, across Market and Manhattan Streets, and later across the New Common to his patrolmen and loiterers alike. The police department's temporary stay would last 15 years. All told, the fire department would occupy the building for 57 years. The early years of the 20th century offered significant challenges to the town's fire department. The continued growth of Norwood's industrial capacity came with a need for housing for workers and their families. Norwood experienced a building boom, most noticeable in the construction of multi-family dwellings. Most were constructed of wood, and many were three stories high. Equipping many of these with modern gas appliances added to the need for the fire department to take their apparatus a greater distance, to scale greater heights, and to deliver more water to fire scenes than ever before. Recognizing the need for full-time leadership, in 1926, John J. Hannigan of East Milton was named the department's first full-time chief. The axiom that something good is worth waiting for has never been better expressed than in the case of the structure built to replace Norwood's temporary town hall. Forward-thinking community leaders reinvented the center of Norwood in the 1920s. Many old buildings were moved or demolished to create a park known as the Common, and later named Veteran of Foreign Wars Square. Across the street, the area formerly occupied by John Day's house would be the site of Norwood's new town hall. Ground was broken in November 1927, and the construction would be completed within 1 year. Norwood's Memorial Municipal Building, built at a cost of $500,000, officially opened on Veterans Day in 1928. The Norwood Messenger estimated the crowd to number 10,000 people. It was the 10th anniversary of the armistice, which ended the war to end all wars. The police department moved into brand new quarters, occupying most of the bottom floor. The entrance for police business was on Central Street. A firing range for pistol practice was included on the top floor of the building. The police continued to use the existing lockup for prisoners. However, upon seeing the ugly little brick lockup as it now sat next to the beautiful new town hall, the town immediately decided to give it a facelift. A stucco finish was applied over the brick and the trim painted in time for the dedication ceremonies. To this day, one has to look closely to see that the lockup was originally a red brick building. Because of delays in vacating the old town hall, it fell upon the town to dismantle the structure itself. The Norwood Public Works Department rose to the challenge and there was no semblance of the old building come dedication day. As Norwood entered the 1930s, its police and fire departments each had adequate facilities to help it deliver its services to the growing town. Over the next 30 years, both departments continued to grow in response to the growth of the town. Both departments were confronted with the challenge of meeting technological advances. The fire department had to deal with the introduction of new materials and chemicals, not only used in Norwood's industries, but also used in building materials and home goods. The police department was challenged by rising crime and a need to educate its officers to utilize technological advances. The post-World War II era saw another building boom. Both departments increased personnel and equipment, and by the late 1950s were outgrowing their quarters. The police department was still using the lockup built in 1879. The fire department was in dire need of more space to house the larger apparatus, which was now necessary to provide fire services. A 1957 committee began looking, at first, for a place to build a new fire station. They selected a tract of land east of the center on Manhattan Street. The land, known as both Dunn's Pond and Dunn's Playground, had been acquired by the town many years before as the result of its owner's inability to pay property taxes. In winter, Dunn's was a popular skating venue. When, in 1948, a young patrolman and young firefighter went into the pond to save a young girl's drowning puppy, they didn't realize they were standing on the site of their future police and fire station. By the time construction was started, the town had decided to add a police station to the building, thereby freeing up the bottom and top floors of the town hall for the expansion of the now cramped town offices. In May of 1964, Norwood dedicated its new 550,000 police and fire facility. Both departments now numbered about 45 members. In hindsight, the building was built just large enough, as both departments would grow to over 60 members by the early 1980s. However, the building was not built high enough. Dunn's Pond had been drained and the land filled in. Some former residents were reluctant to relocate, however, as is evident by a turtle that wandered into the open garage of the station shortly after it opened. Over the next 35 years, the property behind the station would flood some 50 times. Many times the flooding was contained to the parking lot. Often, a couple of inches of water would enter the building. A few times, the height of the flooded quarters reached over 1 foot. By 1998, the personnel in each department now exceeded 70. Much of the operations of each department were located on the bottom level and were vulnerable to the flooding. On the police side of the building, the entire Bureau of Criminal Investigation, evidence storage, and several other administrative offices were now located on the lower level. On the fire department side, the entire vehicle maintenance operation was housed on the lower level. Severe crowding throughout the rest of the building, combined with the constant flooding of the lower level, resulted in many calls for a new facility. Over the years, the formation of several committees, which commissioned several studies, resulted in the acknowledgement of a need for a new facility, but offered no viable site or funding for such a project. In 1996, a detention basin was constructed at the rear of the property, and it performed admirably through that summer and the following summer of 1997. The storms which were most threatening were the sudden thunderstorms often seen during the summer, those that brought very heavy rains over a short period of time. Many such storms came but they were contained. However, a detention basin five times the capacity would not have been able to contain the storm, which came on June 13, 1998. Called by some a 50-year storm, by others a 100-year storm, this deluge dropped 8 inches of rain on Norwood over a period of 3.5 hours on the afternoon of the 13th. Overflow from the detention basin filled the parking lot and threatened the back of the police and fire facility. Members of both departments feverishly attempted to move evidence and equipment out of the danger of the imminent flooding. A corrugated steel garage door buckled under the pressure and the force of the rising water. This event allowed several feet of rushing water to pour into the bottom floor of the building. Several members of the police department were trapped away from the stairway and had to climb out of a window to escape the impending danger. As the water rose to close to 5 feet throughout the bottom floor of the police and fire stations, all efforts to protect town and personal property had proven fruitless. A special town meeting was already scheduled for early in the week, and the topic of the devastation at the police and fire facility moved to the forefront. Constrained by limited town-owned land, suitable as a location for a new police and fire facility, and the expense of purchasing a site privately owned, a site committee was able to offer only a few options. The option chosen by the town meeting was for the town to demolish the current facility, backfill the site to an elevation well above that reached by the June 13, 1998 storm, and build a new combined police and fire facility on the property. The plan called for the acquisition of some parts of several properties on Monroe Street. The building would be placed more to the south and east of the former building's location. It would be built without a basement. Instead, it would rise to 3 stories. Immediately after the storm, the police department moved its Bureau of Criminal Investigation and all other offices that previously were located in the basement, 11 employees in all, to the Recreation Department's Civic Building on Manhattan Street. They would use these temporary offices for 5 years. In March of 2001, the fire department moved to 2 locations. The administrative offices and much of the apparatus moved to the Norwood Memorial Airport. An ambulance and some other apparatus were housed on Central Street. The police department, minus those offices which had moved to the Civic Building, occupied another building at the airport. In May, a groundbreaking ceremony, attended by many current and former members of both departments, marked the beginning of the demolition and construction operation, which would take over 2 years to complete. The Norwood Fire Department and Norwood Police Department would return to its new home in July of 2003.
We'll be right back.